Good morning, gang. It's Sunday, the 2nd of April, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom Talk, coming to you live, boys and girls, live. That is, of course, if you're with us live. How do you know? There's a light not on in here. Did you notice? Look! It's like, what's that thing on the moon? Oh, what's it? It's like an eclipse, isn't it? There's a light not on. Look at that. There we go. We are now fully illuminated, boys and girls. We are fully... You'd think I'd check... I've been sitting here for 40 minutes preparing today's orgy of fun and frivolity, boys and girls. That's what we're doing this morning, providing an orgy of fun and frivolity. Yes, we are. Good morning to you. After I went swimming yesterday, do you remember I went swimming just after the show yesterday? And I came back here and I thought it was time for dinner. So under the grill, I placed two of my lovely Linda McCartney veggie burgers. Very, very tasty indeed. Veggie burgers from Linda McCartney. And I left them under the grill and I'm cooking away. And I needed to go out to the car for something. But I thought, well, I'll do one side first. And then I cleaned up after the cat because she left a little bit of a mess there. Eventually, I turned the burgers over and then I went down out to my car. And I did what I had to do, got some batteries out of the car that I'd left in there that I needed to. I meant to do that again today. Oh, God, I forgot to do that. When I came in today from church, I meant to go to the car, get the batteries and charge them out for a good 5 or 6 hours before the karaoke tonight. Because it's Sunday night tonight. It's our once a month karaoke this evening at the Golden Lion in Sydenham, if you want to come down there. OK, what was I just saying? Oh, how do you know if it's live? There's a little live thing flashing away somewhere on your screen. If you can't see that, you're watching a recording, OK? Those of you on Facebook Live, if you're on Periscope, you know how that works. It's, you know, if it's live or if it's not live, OK? Anyway, so yesterday I went out to the bar, I came back in and I thought, I'll just check my burgers. And there is a bright white light emanating. Now, there's a good word. Try and drop that into a conversation today. Emanating from my oven. I mean, ever so bright, right? What on earth is that going on under there? I thought, well, that doesn't look like a beef burger. Veggie burger. Don't eat meat. We don't eat dead animals. It's not a veg. Don't look like a veggie burger fire to me. And I looked more closely. And the element from the grill had made contact with the metal thing underneath it. And it was glowing bright white. I think it was actually welding it together, dear. Very, very frightening. I thought sparks were about to come flying out of the oven, so I quickly turned it off. Fortunately, the burgers were done, so we didn't waste any food, because you know I don't like wasting food. I quickly turned it off and rescued the burgers before something dropped down from the roof of the oven. And on investigation in there, the element had all gone like crusty around the outside. And I got a knife, remembering, of course, to first switch it off at the mains. Yes, the big red switch that cookers come, you know, that big red switch that electric cookers are controlled with. That was in the off position. I got a knife and I started prodding and the element just snapped. It broke in half. My God, I could have died. No one cares, do they? All this white light coming out of I thought I'd died. And it was that white light that is supposed to project towards you to walk in. Walk into the oven, Chris. I could hear voices in my head. Walk into... This is a Brexit special today, can you tell? Walk into the oven, Chris. Yes. So that's it. Broken oven. No oven. I'm going to starve here. Fortunately, I won't starve today because I've rather naughtily, on the way home from church... I had to pop into the co-op on the way here and I purchased these custard creams. Now, don't start saying, oh, but you gave those up for Lent. No, I didn't. I gave up bread, crisps, cakes and sweets. These are biscuits. These are not bread, cakes, biscuits. These are not cakes, sweets, chocolate or bread. What was the other thing? Is that it? And that's it. This is biscuits. Although I have very, very few biscuits. I felt a little bit peckish. A bit peckish when I came back in from church today. So I bought those. So there we are. So that's the oven. So that was yesterday afternoon. I went to bed, got up again, all ready, and I drove to work using an app that has been recommended to me by a top minicab driver, and he doesn't work for Uber, before you say anything. We don't talk to Uber drivers. They can't. They don't know what they're doing. Oh, yeah, but it's cheaper. Cheaper isn't always good. Believe me, dear. No. So I got in my car and I used a different traffic app, Waze, W-A-Z-E. Now, this satnav thing, it's got the maps on it and all that business. And it's got traffic in it, will reroute you automatically to whichever way is the fastest, you know. Although it doesn't reroute. I mean, if you're going to save 10 seconds or like a minute going that way instead of that way, it doesn't bother rerouting you like that, you know. It's got to be, I think, over 2 minutes difference and then it'll reroute you. And it all works well. And how does this one work? Well, it works through mainly, I think, the people that use it. So if you see traffic up ahead, you touch the little screen and that tells the data center, whatever it is, that there's traffic on that route, and it tells everyone else who's logged onto Waze. Isn't that clever? So I used that for the first time last night and it was quite good. And the best thing about it all, gling, it's completely free of charge. Oh, Dino uses Waze. Oh, I'll come to your messages in a minute. Dino, oh, I'd like to know your opinion of that, please. If you've got a few minutes to call in a minute. Not yet. Not yet. I haven't finished my patter yet. Wait till I finish my patter and I'll ask you to, if you want to call in, that is. I never force anyone to call in, dear. A lot of people just like to sit there and take it easy, especially on a Sunday, don't you? Anyone in bed? Honestly, I was up at I get up at 7:30 on a Sunday morning, you know. Yes, 7:30, I have my breakfast. Then I jump on my bike and I cycle through fields to get to my church in Wokingham, Corpus Christi. It's a nice little church in there. It did make me laugh. Oh, the lady who sits next to me, Vivian, I do like her very much. She's very proper. Vivian is very proper. And she opened her prayer book and she said, have you seen this, Chris? And it was a picture of two gay blokes sitting on a settee with a young lad standing in front of them saying, I'm sorry, dads, I want to come out as being Roman Catholic. I thought that was excellent. Do you think she's trying to tell me that she knows? Excellent, excellent, excellent. Thank you, Vivian, for that mildly amusing little thing. Excellent thing. So as I say, I went to church and I came back, bought the custard creams and some vegetables. And when I got indoors, I opened the door and this smell hit me. Yep, Katie the cat has made a mess again. Not only has she made a mess, she's walked round and round and round in it. And that's where the smell comes from. Fortunately, because of my puppy pads that I now have over the whole of the kitchen floor, it's a fairly simple task. And although sometimes you can't stick... These puppy pads come with little four little sticky bits, one on each corner. But if you stick them to the floor and then you try and pull it up, the sticky bits stay on the floor. And it creates just as much mess like that. So now I just place them on the floor. Now, that means sometimes they move a bit, but it's not too bad. Most of the mess was on the puppy pads. I picked up, I think, three of them. Oh, honestly, I cannot describe the smell to you. It is just dreadful. Of course, she's quietly sitting up there on a little stool, fast asleep, oblivious to me cleaning up after her. No, how ungrateful can you be? You know... Oh, well. So I picked up the mess, put it out, and then I thought, oh, well, I'll mop the floor anyway. So I've mopped the floor down there and then come up to have a chat with you today. So greetings to you. Greetings. Last night, as I say, I used Waze to get to work. And then when I got to work, we had cabaret on. The excellent Lizzie Drip, that is a drag cabaret performer. She's very, very good and a really nice person as well. The only thing is when Liz is on the stage, she has a kind of dressing room, kind of like just a curtain. And there's no room for me up there. I'm squeezed. I do like a bit of a squeeze. I'm squeezed into a tiny corner surrounded by these curtains there. But it all worked well. And it was a lovely night, actually, last night. Excellent entertainment from her. And on the way home, once again, I fired up my Waze and followed it on the way to work, and it worked very well. So there we are. Now, for some reason, my camera 2, look at that. That's not working this morning. I don't know why that is. It's gone blank on me, so I'll work on that a little bit later on and see how that is. All right, boys and girls, phone lines are now open if you want to call in at any point today. Dino, I don't know if you're with us. Dino, if you're with us, if you could call in about your experience with Waze, because I've only used it once so far, and I have to say it wasn't particularly busy on the road, so I don't know how well it works. And as I say, if you want to try that one, boys and girls, it's completely free. It is actually now owned by Google. Did you know that? Waze is owned by Google. Now, Google have their own sat-nav thing, again, completely free of charge, which is Google Maps. I think it's called Google Maps, and it reads you where to go. But I gather, even though Google Maps and Waze are owned by the same people, they work very differently. So I don't know if you've got any experience of either of those. My main sat-nav thing is I've got TomTom, but they are retiring that particular app in September. And I'm always way ahead. I am a leader, boys and girls. I am a leader. I'm way ahead of everyone else. And I am preparing for the switch off or the non-updating of TomTom from September. Presumably it will still work, but they just won't update it anymore. Now, I don't know. Obviously, I do know the way to work. Okay, there are several routes I can take. What I don't know is where the traffic is. And that's the whole idea of having one of these. It sees the traffic and attempts to route you around it. It usually does a very good job. Obviously, if all the traffic's going in one way and all the roads are blocked, then it can't get you around that, you know. But it does do a fairly good job. So I don't know if you're still with us this morning, Demon. Dino, if you want to give us a call about your experience with Waze, or indeed anyone else, the phone lines are open now. It's 020-8144-3477. 020-8144-3477. It's a local London number. You will not be charged a premium at all. A local London number. 020-8144-3477. If you've got Skype, you can Skype in. My Skype name is, all one word, United Kingdom Talk. So United Kingdom Talk, the Skype name. 020-8144-3477 is the phone number. Let's say good morning to some of our early birds this morning. Good morning to Jerry Millen. Morning, Jerry. Hope you're well up there today. Zach Thompson is with us this morning. Lovely Heidi, who's in a very posh area of Fulham. Fulham Earls Court in London. Very posh. You won't be able to afford there. Heidi has had to sell everything she's got just to have a very small box room in Fulham, haven't you, darling? I used to go to school in Fulham, Heidi. Probably you're quite close to it. London Oratory School, which is kind of behind and a little bit further back from Fulham Broadway Station. And when I was going to school, all those shops at Fulham Broadway Station never existed. That is, I mean, it's new to me. It's probably been there about 20, 25 years now, all those shops and what have you. But that was all done up, wasn't it? Looks very, very posh there now. Yes. Good morning to Rod Brown. We're just about in morning, aren't we? Daniel Rolf from Camberley is there. Good morning, Daniel. Why did I go to Camberley the other day? I got diverted the other day. You didn't see the show yesterday, did you? The diversions I had to follow on Thursday because I travel into London on a Thursday night, around about 9 o'clock at night. And they'd closed the M3. They'd closed the road going to Guildford, so I couldn't go down there through Chobham and then to the M25. Couldn't do that one either. So then I went down the M3 to your junction, Junction 4. Oh, is that? No, that's Fleet. Is it Fleet or Farnborough? You know, the next one, Junction 4, right? So I came off that thinking I'll be able to go back onto the M3 there. Nope, they closed that one as well. So I ended up going back exactly the same way as I came through Camberley and back to Bagshot and back to Bracknell following the A30 all the way to London. What a blooming nightmare that was. Hello to Kevin Webster. Where was the drag last night? Well, on the stage, Kevin. Where else would it be? Am I missing something there? Where would the drag be? Where was the drag? Well, there was on the stage. I don't know. Not quite sure what you mean there. Heidi says, what is the music? It's fab. Ah, well, that music is... One moment. That music you hear is by David Arnold. Now, it is the long theme song to a radio station in the 80s. But it's now they haven't used it for 20, 30 years now. So I heard it and I asked David Arnold, who wrote the music, and you would have heard other stuff written by him, okay? If I could use the music, he's written scores for James Bond, TV jingles, theme songs, everything. He's you would have heard music by him, even if you didn't know the name. And I wrote to him and asked permission to use it, and he said yes. So that's nice, isn't it? All right, so that's what that is, Heidi. Good morning to Richard Sutherland. Good morning, sir. I hope you're doing well. You're very, very quiet, Richard. Never hear from you anymore. Elaine's there. Well, Chris, how patriotic are you with me? This is a Brexit special today. It's a Brexit special. We are supporting our country. We are, dear. I'm just waiting for someone to ring in now and say, that's a really racist jacket you got on. Oh, get a life, will you, for Christ's sake. Get a life. Wendy says, loving the poppy picture. Thank you for noticing, Wendy. We do try and rotate the pictures when I remember. And that picture actually went up 2 seconds before I had to click the button and from the opening video to me. I had it outside and then I couldn't get the damn thing straight. You know what I mean? What do you want me to do? Get one of those things out. What are those things that you put on top of things to make it level? Is that a set square? That level, you know, the thing with it. I've got one here, have I? 1 minute. No. It's got a little bubble in it, like a level. What is all this DIY stuff? I don't know. Kevin loves the jacket. Thank you, Kevin. Heidi says, how is your pussy? Oh, she's downstairs. She's completely incontinent now, I'm afraid. Spirit level. Oh, who's that there? Hello, Daz. Good morning, Daz. Spirit level. Thank you very much for that. Yeah, the little thing with a bubble in it. Although I say that, you know my new Ring doorbell I told you about? That's the video doorbell I've got now. Oh, they're fantastic. I won't tell you what it does again because I've told you about 3 times now. People keep hearing the same damn stories, don't they, all the time? But the Ring doorbell, I had to put a little thing, the button downstairs, which I fixed the wall. And I had a spirit level. I'm telling you now, I had a spirit level and I had that little bubble was in the middle and I put the screws in and it still looked like it was in the middle to me. And then I stood back from the bell. Looks crooked. There must have been something wrong with the spirit level. It looks crooked. I don't know how I managed to put that camera up in front of me so looking straight, although probably bent to some of you. Yes. Mary loves the jacket again. Mary, good morning. Non-Irish Mary, that's Mary Warne. Mary Warne is actually non-Irish Mary from Ireland who often sings at our karaoke nights. She is the one that bought me this lovely, lovely jacket, which I may wear tomorrow night, actually. If Ray Reynolds, I'll try and get hold of Ray Reynolds because he won't be around today. I think he's playing the ukulele somewhere. If we can do that song, you know, da-da-da-da, the one with the Union Jacks and all that. That'd be quite nice tomorrow. Thank you very much, those of you that have shared the video on your walls. That's always very appreciated. Thank you very much for those of you doing that, okay? Elaine says, nice poppy. Is it a holiday in Britain today? Nope, not. Well, all Sundays are holidays, really. Sundays, I don't know, Sundays are supposed to be a little bit special. They used to be special. Not so much anymore, I don't think, really. We've got a phone call coming in. Good morning, who's that? Hello? No, no one there. Never mind. Yes, Sundays were special. They were always sort of family days. Whether or not you went to church, you know, it doesn't matter. But years ago, of course, a lot more people did. But years ago, it was also considered a holiday. You know, you wouldn't have supermarkets or shops open on a Sunday. And actually, I think it's a great shame that all the shops are open on Sunday. They're not. I mean, certainly Sainsbury's up the road is not a pleasant place to be on a Sunday. It's packed in there. And I suppose people want them open, so that's why they are open. You know, if no one went to the shops on a Sunday, they wouldn't be open. There's plenty of people who go to the shops on a Sunday. Do I? Yeah, sometimes I go. You know, I've just been to the co-op on the way here to get my custard creams. Although corner shops were always around on a Sunday, weren't they? I think some of our lovely Asian friends who run the little corner shops and places like that, I think that a lot of their business was just on... hello, Singh. Good evening, Singh. All right. A lot of the Asian, our Asian friends who and it used to be really just Asian people who had those little corner shops, you know, the sort of mini supermarkets and all that. And I think they used to get an awful lot of their business on a Sunday. And didn't supermarkets used to do half day on Saturdays? I can't remember that now. But that's where they used to make a lot of their money. And of course, when the big supermarkets came along, I think they lost an awful lot of business, the little Asian shops. And I used to love going. When I was married for a very short period of time, there was a little Asian shop, like a mini, what do you call them, a mini mart type thing, just down the road where we lived. We had a room in Earlsfield in London. And he used to go, and he was such a nice man in there. And if there wasn't something in there, he said, well, I can get that for you tomorrow. You know, they really worked hard. And then the big supermarkets came along and cleaned up. I don't think they make an awful lot of money because they work bloody hard, those people. Not just Asians, there are other people running them as well. But generally, I think the little corner shops and the supermarkets like that, they were known by being run by very helpful Asian people who came across and tried to make a laugh. And I suppose for a while it worked until the supermarkets came along and cleared up, you know. And I do think it's a great shame, Elaine, that all these shops are open on a Sunday. Should be a family day. When I was a child, my mum and dad, we'd also, and my sister, of course, there was myself and my sister, my mum and dad would take us out every Sunday somewhere, every single Sunday. In the summer, we generally go to Brucklesham Bay, which is a lovely little seaside place that we liked going to. That was the one we went to far more than any others. I don't remember going to Brighton, really. Bognor, I think we went to Bognor as well. But mainly it was Brucklesham. We always went to Brucklesham Bay, which even to this day is not built up and commercialised. There's no big shop with loads of fruit machines in it or anything like that. It's a lovely little quiet place. Quite expensive to live there as well, because I've looked, you know, even the caravans down there, because I aspire within the next year or two, perhaps, to owning a caravan somewhere, although it's likely to be up near my sister so that I can stay up there and see my great nieces and great nephews. And just a minute, can I just... I think I've left the autofocus on that. Just a second. Let's just try and turn that off. Otherwise, that will annoy me. I thought I had. Right, save that. And okay. Is that camera back on? Nope, nothing. Look at that. Isn't that strange? Strange and mysterious. Probably someone from ITV who is jealous of the ratings of this programme has broken into this house today and damaged my camera. Yes. Anyway, so Brucklesham Bay, that was the seaside. Other times of the year, including the summer, but in the autumn, you didn't really want to go down the seaside. So we went to Box Hill. We went there quite often, you know, running around on the, trying to run up and down that hill. And a place called Leith Hill, L-E-I-T-H, I think it was a funny spelling. Leith Hill, which I think was in Surrey somewhere. We went to Epsom Downs. Had a run around over there, and I remember my dad trying to get me to play football. Of course, I had no interest in football at all. No interest. I think it must have been a gay thing. I never told my dad I was gay. I'm probably glad that I didn't, because I think men of that time would have had a really hard time in understanding. And I'm not one of those people who shoved it. You know, take me as I am or go away. That's not me at all. So I never told my dad I was gay. Probably that's why I didn't like the football. So I kind of watch him kick this ball. Box Hill, as I say, Leith Hill, Epsom Downs. There was another place, Oxshott. And these were all like tree, grassy type places. Oxshott in particular, that was a bit more foresty, if I remember rightly. And there was a... All these places had a little place where you could have tea. You know, we're not talking McDonald's. We're talking old hall or room with a few wooden tables and chairs in it. And the one in Oxford, it was almost like a scout hut. I remember it being quite big. And I think there was a fruit machine, not a fruit machine, one of those with a little ball. Ding, 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 ding. Oh, I've just seen a job come up in Hawley, Surrey, for a karaoke night. April the 16th. Am I here? Oh, I'm on holiday. Look at that. What a shame. Can't do that one then. not a fruit machine. Sing wants to know, love the brazier. Where's the red sparkly Bingay one? You look younger. Oh, I did have once a red sparkly jacket. I sold that to John, my good friend John, who runs a pub in Ealing. So that's where that one is. And talking of bingo, someone has asked me to think about doing a bingo night in Hemel Hempstead. So we're kind of talking about that at the moment. So that might be fantastic. It'll be done proper. We're not going to have a machine, you know, a computer popping up numbers on a screen. No, we will have balls. We will have coloured balls and a proper thing swirling it around. You know, it costs an arm and a leg, they do. There's only one way to do these things, and that is properly. So I'll have to buy a bingo machine for hundreds of pounds. But do not worry. Tax deductible item. Need it for the job. Thank you very much, Inland Revenue. We'll have a bingo machine out of you next. You see, that's the idea. When you're self-employed, if you buy something to make you money, you can write off that item against tax. That's how it all works. Anyway, back to Oxshot. Yeah, they had one of those machines. Pinball machine in there. And I'd play, I think Mum would give us like sixpence. I'm sure it was sixpence to put in this machine. And we'd have a cup of tea, maybe a cake or something, and then go out in the forest and walk around. So that's what we used to do on a Sunday. Of course, you don't do it now, do you? You know, you drag your lazy old asses out of bed at about 12 o'clock in the afternoon. I bet some of you are watching me in bed now, aren't you? For God's sake, man or woman, come on, get out there. Have you seen it out there? Have you seen it out there? You've got to be very careful to say man and woman now because people get upset. Oh, that's what I meant to tell you. There was some stupid cow in the Daily Mail on Friday, it was. Right, Friday. So get this story. Now, listen to this carefully, OK? Listen to this carefully and see if you can work out what was going on before I tell you what I thought was going on, OK? All right? So this woman was in the Daily Mail yesterday. She was complaining that the bloke that served her in a BP petrol garage somewhere was misogynic, you know, against women, that sort of thing, right? What had happened? She'd gone into a BP garage, bought her petrol, whatever. The bloke then had said to her, "Do you want a VAT receipt so your boyfriend can do the accounts?" That's all he said to her. And the next thing, she's in the Daily Mail complaining that he's misogynic, you know, assuming that women can't do the accounts. Now, I'm sorry, is she completely stupid and thick or what? Now, I want you to think about that for a second, and I'll come back to that in a minute, all right? You think about that, see if you can work out what actually went on then, rather than that stupid cow writing to the Daily Mail or whatever happened there, one of the papers, I think it was. See if you can work that out. I'll come back to that in a minute and I'll tell you what it was. Good morning to Shania. Good morning to the lovely Shania on Isley Widget. Hope you've been to church this morning, Shania. We did Lord Jesus Think on Me this morning. Oh, it's a bit dreary, that one. A little bit depressing, that one. A bit depressing, that one. Good morning to Elaine. It's in the top left. What's in the top left? What's in the top left? Top left of what? My pocket? Zach says, Waze is... Ah, look at this. Zach says the app Waze is brilliant. I use it for work, especially in driving up to Reading. The M3 can be crazy sometimes. Zach, that's when it's open, mate. They keep closing it. Do you know, it's going to be finished, I think, in December this year. How long has that been going on? The M3, what a joke, honestly. Good morning to Craig. Hope you're well, Craig. Good morning, Craig. Heidi says, my neighbour's boys used to go to the London Oratory. Ah, well, they're well brought up then, my dear. Well brought up. Hello to John Aitken. Where have you been hiding? John says, I'm going out to enjoy the sun with my other half. Got my sun cream on. Can't wait. Oh, do you need anything rubbed in, John? Just let me know. I'll pop over and rub a bit in for both of you if you want to. Kevin says, sorry, I thought you might have showed. Oh, on this live stream. No, sorry, Kevin. No, didn't show. There wouldn't have been any room for a camera last night. All she's got so many costumes and that they do take up half the stage, which is curtained off. So I do generally ask the artists if they want to be on there. If I think they're going to say yes, I'll ask. But sometimes they don't want to be on there, you know. And it may be sometimes it's probably a bit rude for internet anyway, but there we are. Adam says, have you had a chance to read your Slimming World book yet? You must be joking, Adam. I'm go here, dear. I've not had a chance at all. Not had a chance at all. This morning, if I can find my wood glue, I'm going to attempt Chris Reardon's DIY. Oh, yes, boys and girls. I've got this little shoe rack that I bought from Tesco's. No, not Tesco, from The Range. And honestly, it's so cheap and awful. It really is. It's this wood thing that you put together. There's no glue or nails or screwing. In fact, the wood is so weak, it's unbelievable. And one of the rods snapped. So I'm going to try and glue that together and repair it. If not, I may go on the John Lewis website and see if they can buy a proper shoe rack. Chris Reardon, DIY services. Can I help you? Yes. Oh, I never finished telling you about the oven, did I? God, I haven't finished telling you about the oven yet. So the oven, as I say, it was the element broke after it turned bright white. It was obviously welding itself to the other part of the metal with all those electrical volts going through it. So that's it. So the oven's broken. And I thought, shall I have it repaired? But you know what? It's about 22 years old, that oven. So I'm getting a new one. Now, my mate Ron recently bought a new oven. £500, dear. God, they got more money than sense, some people. 500 quid he spent on an oven. Why is that then? Oh, because it's that one. Because that's the one we want, him and his boyfriend. And that's the one we want. So I went out on Amazon last night. First of all, I typed in oven with timer and it came up a selection. And then I looked at a couple and I came across a Russell Hobbs one on the Currys website. OK, the Currys website. Now, I don't buy anything from Currys. I find their service awful. The staff in there seem completely disinterested. It's a dreadful place to shop. I don't buy anything in Currys. So this oven on there was, I think... Oh gosh, do you want me to look it up? One moment, please. Trying to connect you, dear. Just a minute. Five. So I ended up buying it on Amazon. OK, I would have bought it from either John Lewis or Amazon. They're the only place generally I buy stuff from there, to be honest, especially big things. OK, so it's a Russell Hobbs. Russell Hobbs oven Currys. OK, there it is. Got to tell you this. Russell Hobbs oven. Ah. Oh. And of course I can't find it now. Hang on. Oven with timer. Currys. Let's try that one. Oven with timer. Currys. Oven deals. Is it oven deals? Can we search for Russell Hobbs? Where's that Russell Hobbs one? Oh, yes, we can. View more filters. Oh, Russell Hobbs isn't on there. How annoying is that? I'm not going to find that, am I? I wanted to get the price right for you because there was such a huge difference. Oh, hang on. Item number. Or maybe if I type that in. What's that? RHE0650. RHE0650. Let's see what if anything comes up there. Russell Hobbs. Oh, no, I can't find it now. Can you believe that? Is it more to the number? 06501SS. Oh, okay. 1SS. It's all very complex here. One moment, please. No, can't find it now. Okay, well, never mind. It came up on Currys for £329. So I got the code number, the model number, the RHE06. I've put a no instead. Oh, hang on. No, I'll leave it now. Anyway, it was £329 in curries. On Amazon, £197.99. Can't go wrong, can you? £197 for that one. So I've ordered that off Amazon. And that will come. Now, if I remember rightly, the last oven I bought, which I think it was about 20, 25 years ago now, it just plugged in. It came with a plug on the end and you just plugged it in. So I've got like a socket in the little hole because they are, I'm assuming they're all the same size ovens, are they? I hope the hole's not going to be too small or too big. There's nothing worse than a hole that's too big, is there? There really isn't. Oh, God, it just doesn't touch the size, does it? So I might even take the old one out today and remove it from its hole and then put that on the floor and prepare for my new oven that should be arriving next week from Russell Hobbs. £197. Ding! Thank you. I think that's a bit of a bargain. There we are. Okay, let's go back to that. thank you, John. Spirit level, you numpty. You're quite right. You're quite nice. Heidi, the phone number is up on the screen, dear. Do pay full attention to the show and you'll see what's going on, okay? 020-8144-3477 is the phone number. Rod said someone was talking on your phone similar to what happened a few weeks ago when you did not press a button. Yes, I forgot to press the button a few weeks ago, didn't I? Very, very naughty of me. I've got two buttons down here that I must press. As soon as I come on, you see. Hello to Wendy, who says, I remember the video you did from Brucklesham Bay a couple of years ago. 2 years ago I did that, Wendy. God, where does this time go? Wendy says, Heidi, the number is below. Oh, yes, there you are. Wendy is. Wendy, can you not see? Heidi, can you not see the number on there, dear? Why aren't people paying full attention? I hope I'm not in the background. I will not be on in the background. You sit there and pay full attention to this programme. Craig says, I love bingo. My mum won a full house last night at our working man's club. Only thing was she had to share £25. She won, it would have been 50. Yeah, I won 50 quid. I won 50 quid at a bingo years and years ago. Oh, I shout at the other. House! My Nanny Hayes, used to love bingo. She would have, and this is no word of a lie, my Nan would have 12 bingo tickets sitting there next to each other. God knows how she did those. My Nan loved the bingo. Nanny Hayes. Good morning to nephew Jimmy Butler is with us today on the first full day of his 20 years. It was his birthday yesterday. He was 20 years old yesterday. And his girlfriend, Charlotte, took him to a hotel for the night. God knows what happened there. Oh, my God. But he's not well at the moment. He's not well at the moment. He's going to be working on my car soon because there's a little dent that has appeared in the door. So he's going to be fixing my car up soon in a couple of weeks when I go up to visit. All right, we've got a phone call coming in on a mobile. Good morning. Who's that?
Hello, love.
Good morning, Heidi. How are you, darling?
I'm all right, honey. How are you?
Now, how can you not know that the phone number is up there? Can't you see it, dear?
Dad, you know what? I've only just noticed it. It's over your left shoulder. I've only just noticed it.
Oh, is it not prominent enough? Does it need to be more prominent?
No, it's behind you. I can see it now.
All right, turn me off on that other blooming thing you've got on there. I can hear myself, my love. It's not a very pleasant experience listening to yourself. How are you, Heidi? All right, darling?
I'm all right, love. How are you?
I'm very well, dear. What are you ringing in for this morning, my love?
Well, I'm not really over keen on that jacket.
You're not keen on the jacket? Oh.
No.
Oh, what's wrong with this? Is it a little bit too glary for you, dear?
No, it just looks like something Jeremy Jones if you wear.
Oh, my God. Let me take that off immediately. All right, it's gone.
Exactly.
It's gone.
Exactly.
Oh, come on, Jeremy Joseph. Don't dress up to go on stage, dear. I don't think he does he? Don't he go on in an old T-shirt and a pair of tight jeans, which are too tight for him?
Dave, that is tacky. It doesn't suit you, Chris. You're better than that.
It's not tacky. It's lovely. It's very patriotic, darling. We must fly our union flags outside, lovey.
Well, yeah, but It's a bit loud, love.
Bit loud, dear? There's no loudness in this room, only me shouting at you, lovey.
Actually, I saw when you went by the other week, when you was in the pub in Central Station.
Oh, you've been watching our little karaoke shows, have you?
Yeah, I've only watched one. It was wicked. It was well good.
Oh, but they've been on there for quite some time now. I think we've been doing those for over a year. It's fairly simple to just like set up a little camera in front there. But the difference is between me and most of the others that do it, I plug the sound straight in. So you get the sound directly off the microphone, not like in the audience. Because often, you know, people, I don't know why they do it sometimes, but they sit there at concerts and things and they film the whole show through this blooming mobile phone and it don't sound good.
No.
Perhaps you should start doing your own shows, Heidi.
Oh, God, no, thank you.
Are you liking the idea of that?
No, I'm not at all.
Anyway, I've put the jacket back on again, my darling, I'm afraid. Sorry, lovey.
No, that's all right.
Perhaps if you turn down the brightness on your screen, it might not be as loud.
No, it wouldn't be you if you didn't have it on. So I think I'd miss it if it wasn't on.
Oh,
so,
bless.
No, you're right to put it on.
You say your neighbours boys go or used to go to the London Oratory, did they?
Oh, they used to go, yeah. When I first got to know them when they were 13 and 15.
Yes.
And they went off to the Oratory. And then from the Oratory, they went off to Cambridge and Oxford.
Yeah, a lot of people go to it was always the case, actually, that a lot of people that went to London Oratory went to university. I can't think of anything more boring than carrying on school when you don't need to. I was out of there, dear. Well, I did stay in. I stayed in for the sixth form, but it was a really complete waste of time in my case because I didn't learn anything else. I'm not very good at learning from books, Heidi. I prefer to do or be shown something, you know?
Yeah, I'm like that. I prefer to do rather than be shown. I can't sit down and be taught. I hate that.
Where did you go to school, Heidi?
Oh, I didn't go to school in London.
Where was that then?
Because I was born in Manchester.
Yes.
No, I was born in Ipswich.
Yeah.
Then I moved to Manchester when I was very young. Then I moved from Manchester when I was about 3 years old. Moved to Wimbledon, which is Cheshire, then moved back to Manchester when I was about 10.
Did you like school?
Did I like...
Secondary school. Did you like secondary school or not?
I don't think I ever got to secondary school because I always went to special schools with a special unit.
Okay. Did you like it there?
Some of them I liked, some of them I didn't.
But your special school, is it like...
Yeah.
Like a general school where you would do certain subjects at certain times, or didn't it work like that?
No, it was a special school, especially.
Yes.
Children with learning disabilities.
Yeah, but I know that. But did there used to be like an English lesson, and a maths lesson, and a science?
Yeah.
So that's the same.
We used to follow a normal English curriculum. Yeah.
Yes.
But just, like, not as advanced.
Okay. And what would have been your favourite thing to do at school?
Computers.
Oh, really? See, how old are you? I'm 54. You're about 10 years younger than me or less?
I'm 46 in 3 weeks.
46. See, we never had computers at our school. There were no computers. They didn't exist.
We did at my school in style, we did.
And you liked...
Every time I went into the computer lesson, because all the other kids were doing it wrong, they used to come to me to sort it out.
Really? What sort of thing would you do on the computers? Will you be designing web or programming them or what?
Well, you know, they'd give us, like, programs to do, but then they'd often get it wrong and I'd have to get up and go collect it and, oh...
So were you actually programming the computer yourself?
Yeah, we were all doing it in the lesson, but it was more like they were getting it more wrong than right.
Yeah.
And I had to get up and go around and do it all right for everybody else.
Wow.
So I spent more time doing their work than doing my work.
Well, I had a Sinclair Spectrum, and I managed to write a couple of programs in BASIC. But with that, they all write in, like, machine code, which all looks gobbledygook to me. I wouldn't have a clue what to do with that, Heidi. Not a clue. Mm.
Well, actually, I excelled at computers.
Good. Oh, and what lessons did you hate the most?
I excelled at computers as far as to the point I hacked British Airways.
Eh?
I hacked into British Airways.
You hacked into British Airways?
Yeah. I actually hacked into the system.
Did they know?
From my home computer.
Should you be telling me that on the air? How many years ago was that? About 30 years?
Like, this is like when I was about 10.
10 years old?
I think they've forgot about it by now.
Is there any lessons that you didn't like at school?
I'm not too good on maths.
Maths? No, I wasn't very good at maths. I got I think I got E. E for maths, which is quite low down. What I couldn't understand was we were learning stuff and I'm thinking, well, how is this going to help me in life? You know, algebra. When have I ever used algebra since I left school? Never. Never used it.
I never got as far as algebra.
No.
I thought, leave it. Don't want to touch it with a barge pole.
Wow. Well, I'm glad you enjoyed the computers and keep on them, Heidi. All right, darling?
Oh, I love computers.
You lovely.
I'm what you call tech support in this house.
Tech support. Good afternoon. Yeah. Heidi, technical support. Can I help you with your inquiry? £1.50 a minute, please.
No, because for my boyfriend, he knows some stuff about computers, but he doesn't know everything.
Well, you should be charging him premium rate number. £1.50 a minute, my love.
So it's like we've both got iPhones and he doesn't really know how to work his property. So he comes to help me. That's good.
Very good. Lovely to talk to you, Heidi, darling. Thanks for calling in, my love. All right?
All right. Got to get on.
Enjoy your Sunday. Bye-bye, love.
Bye-bye.
There we are. Lovely Heidi calling in from Fulham in London there. Let me just do that. Save. There we are. Always nice for people to call in like that, isn't it? Let's go back to some of your messages here coming in today. And we are... Bum, bum, bum. Adam says, will you need the service of Adam the Plumber, plumbing and maintenance services to install your new cooker? Probably not, Adam. If I remember rightly, because that one was replaced itself about 25 years ago, you literally undo two screws, pull it forward, out it comes, unplug it, chuck that away, plug the new one in, push it in, do up a couple of screws and that's it. So probably not, Adam. However, never say never, lovey. It may be that I get into terrible state and I may need your assistance. Do not worry, I shall call. And I'm calling you. La da da da. Yes, thank you. Stephen says, good day, Chris. I like your jacket. Where can I get one? I believe Amazon. I believe Amazon do these jackets, Stephen. So have a look on there, my friend, all right? Wendy says, put the jacket back on. Absolutely, it's back on. Thank you, Wendy. Back on. It's back on. Good morning to Wayne Martin, who's with us this morning. Good morning, Wayne. Sitting next to yet another good-looking young man in your photograph. Who's that one? Who's that one? Why don't I know any of these people? God. Good morning to Tanya Sheridan. Good morning, Tanya. Lily's with us this morning. Morning, lovely Lily. She likes the flower behind, the lovely poppy that we've got behind us this morning. Hello to Ashley Russell. Good morning, Ashley. Hope you're well this morning. How are you today? It's always such a pleasure, Ashley, to have a little sensible conversation while you come up to the front of the stage with me. It really is nice of you to come up and have a little chat, a nice chat that we have. There we are. So that's it. Right, let's do some stories this morning, boys and girls. Look at this one. Now, Tom Jones. Now, I'm a believer in kind of what he's saying here in a roundabout way. If you don't carry on your die Tom Jones reveals his therapist's words of warning during his darkest days after wife's Linda's death. He admits time off work could mean death. Linda, his lovely wife, lost her battle with cancer in 2016. Tom Jones was married to her for 59 years. That's a long, long time. That's a lovely marriage, isn't it? 59 years. You hardly hear that anymore. Probably your mums and dads were married for years and years, but I don't think young people are going to stay together that long anymore. I really don't. You know, they've just got an app. Oh, yeah, let's get someone else. And that's the straight world and the gay world. Both of you. Both of it. I've got an app now. Oh, let's see what we can have tonight. Flick, flick, flick. Oh, let's have that one tonight. Yeah, do you want to come over? That's it. That's it, I'm afraid. These long-term years and years relationships have gone out the window, and I think it's a great shame. Tom Jones revealed he had therapy to help him. The Welsh singer was urged to visit a therapist by his son Mark after struggling to get out of bed following the death of his childhood sweetheart Linda. That's in this morning's Daily Mail. And he added, when my wife passed away, God bless her, I didn't know whether I would make it. There were days where I thought I just couldn't get up. And he told the newspaper, time off would be death for me. The only time I take time off is when I die. I don't take long periods of time off. I'm happier when I'm singing than when I'm not. And I can relate to this. I can absolutely relate to this. You won't see me go on holiday very often. Or when I do, it's only for a few days at a time. I just, you know, I love going to see my great nieces and great nephews up north. I love it. I love it. But I think if you take too much time off, or if you retire, that's the one. If you retire, you know, work, and suddenly you do nothing. I honestly think that finishes you off. I really do. It's important to keep doing something. I mean, I'm lucky, even if I was to leave all my jobs, which I won't, you know, I probably won't do that. There's a couple that are probably, I may well get rid of next year, because at 55, I got a little private pension. Don't get too excited. 50 quid a week. What a bloody waste of time that is. I don't even know if it goes up over time, but 50 quid's 50 quid, isn't it? So I might get rid of a couple next year. What I'd like really is 3 days together so that I can finish work, say, I don't know, on whatever day, and then drive up north to my caravan. I like a caravan up there, and I'll spend 3 days there visiting and doing stuff like that, which is lovely. If I was to give up all my jobs, you know, I've still got this. I'd still come up and chat to you. I mean, every day. I don't know how it's worked, where I now come up almost every day of the week and have about an hour's chat with you. I don't know how that happened. I really don't. But it did. And I like to have a chat with you. I do. If I was to retire, I'd probably I'd still do this every day. Maybe more so. I don't know. Something like that. I like to chat. I'd love to have had a chat type show on the radio or the telly, but that would probably never happen. Part of the reason is myself. I do not push myself. I cannot make tapes and send them off to people for fear of rejection. I think I have a terrible fear of rejection, really. So once I've found something that I like doing, I just keep at it. And of course, with this thing that I'm doing now, you can't really reject, you know. I mean, if everyone switched off, I suppose, would that be looked at as a rejection? I don't know, really. But yes, I've never really looked into it. I don't know where to go. I wouldn't know who to contact. You know, I mean, this is a little chat show I do. Do you think there's something I could do on the telly or on the radio? I don't really do that. I've never really done that. Other people often say, you know, you should be doing this. I happen to know. LBC comes up a lot. You should be on LBC. Now, I know that I would not fit in on there. And I keep telling people that. And they send messages, oh, you'd be fantastic on there. No, I wouldn't. No, I wouldn't. In fact, I've got a very good friend, Warren, who knows Steve Allen on LBC, and he played one of my shows to him. And he said, I like it, but he doesn't fit in on LBC. There you go. It's come from the man himself. And I knew that anyway. But where would I fit in somewhere like that? And I kind of do these sometimes. Sometimes I think to myself, oh, maybe someone will see this one day. And then perhaps a little job would be offered like that. But it's not something, if this was a paid job, I wouldn't be thinking, right, well, I've only got to do this for another 2 years, then I can retire. No, you want to keep doing it. You see, I think this is like an entertainment thing, isn't it? You know? I don't think you retire from any entertainment stuff, whether you are Barry Manilow or singing at a karaoke bar or DJing somewhere or doing something like this. I don't think you retire from entertainment. Entertainment retires you. Eventually, people get fed up with the same thing. They do. And that's just how it is. You know, if Shirley Bassey was here every morning doing a show, you'd soon get fed up with it. We love Shirley. We love Shirley. So that's the Tom Jones thing there. I do think if you give up, then that's the end of you. So if you are close to retirement or you have retired and you do nothing, go out and get a little part-time job or a voluntary thing or join some groups or do something. You can't just sit at home and mong in front of the telly. It'll kill you. And that goes for some of the youngsters as well. Might be some younger people watching it. When I say younger people, I mean anyone under the age of 50. That's young to me. Anyone under the age of 50. You know, is that what you do all day? Sit at home watching the telly? You'll get ill. Mark my words, you'll get ill. You've got to go and do something. Even if it was a bit of gardening a couple of times a week. Or maybe you haven't got a garden. Have you got just a flat? We can make pots, can't you? Do something. Don't just get up and flummox in front of the telly playing computer games or watching endless Jeremy Kyle crap. It'll do you in eventually. And Tom Jones says the same, OK? Some of your messages coming through here. Just a moment, please. Oh, let's just scroll back. How far did we get before? Ashley. There's our lovely Lily. I love you, Lily. You're such a nice person. Do you know where we do the karaoke at Central Station? Where there's everyone is such nice people in there. If you missed the show yesterday, I must tell you, Maureen's got a little bit of a bad throat at the moment. She's not too well. So that's where she was Friday. I know some of you missed her from the live karaoke stream on Friday. Good afternoon to Lee, who says, good afternoon, Chris and everyone. I'm chilling at home after a great long Elvis tribute show. Oh, excellent. My ex-wife used to love Elvis Presley. Oh, it was on all the time. Elvis. The films. I must have watched the films a dozen times. Well, they're the good films, aren't they? What's the one where he's in? Isn't he in a fairground or something in one of the films? I think Elvis in a fairground. Good afternoon to niece-in-law. So my nephew's wife, niece-in-law. About right. Stacey's with us. Evie says hello. Hello, Evie. Evie's 4 years old. I should be coming up. I'm going on holiday with them soon. I should be up in a couple of weeks to see you all right? Hello to Evie and also Harry and Olivia, who's got a new building now, which is all looking very nice with lots of flashing lights and things. So hello to you and little Harry. Harry, Chris Reardon. Chris Reardon is Harry, yes. Gary Stevens says, just do it. I'm doing it now, Gary. Hello. Hello, Gary. All right. Gary Stevens is with us today. Gary does a lot of little videos like me. Unlike me, he's pushing himself a bit more to try and get something on the telly. He does little videos with Only Way as Essex People and what's that other thing? The X Factor, all those Britain's Got Talent and all that business. Stacey says, please come and live here. I might get a caravan next year, Stacey. Possibly getting a caravan. Although Tattershall Lakes is my preferred place of caravan, but they're a bit dear there. The ground rent is like $4,500 a year there. Although I don't know if they've got any cheaper pitches there, but they're a bit dear up there, the caravans in Tattershall Lakes. I don't know about the other one, Willow Holt. That's quite close by. It might be worth having a look at that one as well. But that's not till next year, you know. Gary says, ITV, I'm fed up of all their shows. Yeah, me too. Is anyone watching ITV anymore? It's all gone terribly wrong there, dear. Terribly, terribly wrong. ARC, Gary's sent loads of stuff up. Many rejections. And Radio Kent, what? Did you try Radio Kent, did you? My friend was on that. When I used to do an overnight show in London on Liberty Radio in London. And Dave Cash was before me. Who became friends with me. He was a lovely man, Dave Cash. And we sadly lost him last year, didn't we? Lee says, never give up. I agree. Del Boy says, this time next year, he who dares wins. Maybe so. Who's daring? What are you going to? What do you want to dare me to do? Perhaps I should do a daring or something like that. Ashley says, I'm still waiting for my mug, dear. As I said, I'll see you on Friday. Did I put another one? Was there another one? Now, what did I say to you Friday? Oh, I said if there was one, there's one with someone's name on it in the car. But if they don't come within a couple of weeks, so you can have that one, all right? But there aren't any more. I'm not having any more mugs made, I'm afraid, because they take they do get damaged, certainly get damaged in the post and that sort of thing, all right? Okie doke. Let me just refresh things here. Sometimes it gets a little bit wrong. I miss some. Now, where's all those blooming comments disappeared to? Oh, is it that one there? No. It's gone a little bit wrong there. Hang on a minute. I think they do get they get jammed up sometimes. That's better, isn't it? Is that good? Have I got that now? There we go. Radio Kent the same. That was the last one. I've read that out, haven't I? Okay. Now, good news, boys and girls, for all things British. Da, 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 da. Look at this. Blue passports are to be brought back. Hooray! Oh, let me just get my old European passport out. One moment, please. Where is that now? One minute. Oh, hang on. That's the old one. One minute. Oh, here it is. Oh, look at that. I mean, isn't it awful, the colour on this? Would you like to see my passport photo? Hang on. I don't want to reveal my address to you. You might come round. You might come round and start stealing things. Hang on a minute, let me see. British citizen, there we are. Look, oh. Look at this passport photo. Isn't that awful? I look like a criminal, don't I? Look, that's what. Oh, look at my slim face with no lines on it. How marvellous is that? Chris, does that look like the same person? I don't know. I was in a shop the other day. Collecting DHL or I don't know, but I had to go to a shop. UPS. I was in a UPS. She says, have you got any ID? I said, there you go, it's a credit card. Oh, needs to be have a photo on it. So I got my driving license photo out, and she said, well, it doesn't look like you. My stupid old cow. Well, put your glasses on then, you old bag. Doesn't look like it. Well, they're so awkward as possible, some of these people, aren't they? Anyway, back to this story. Blue passports are to be bought back after Brexit, and the Home Office has already issued a £490 million contract to make them. Thank you very much. Lovely blue passports. Have I got my blue one? One minute. Let's see if I've still got that. No, I haven't got the old blue one. I'm sure I had a blue passport once, but they're coming back. British passports were traditionally a dark navy colour, but as part of the European rules... not for much longer, love! So, you're not going to be able to tell us what to do anymore, are you, my love? As part of the European rules, were switched to the current nasty old burgundy colour in 1988. The current deal expires in 2019. The year is set to leave the European Union after Theresa May began the former two-year thing. So we're going to get the blue passports back. That'd be nice, wouldn't it? That'd be nice. Perhaps we could choose our own colour. Yeah, would you like to choose your own colour passport? I think that would be quite nice, wouldn't it? Eh? Another story here. I'm something going wrong here. This often happens halfway through the show. Oh, there we go. One minute. That's it. There we go. There we are. Hillary Clinton news, boys and girls. Hillary, you know Hillary Clinton. Did you see my impression of Hillary Clinton on yesterday's show? You missed it. Would you like it again? Would you like it again? Okay, okay. Here's my impression of Hillary Clinton yesterday. Right, okay. Just a moment. Just a moment. This is Hillary Clinton as she went to the car when she got pneumonia. Ready? So, hang on. Ah! Poor Hillary, dear. Poor Hillary. Poor Hillary. She looked like a robot, didn't she? It wasn't much of a choice those poor Americans had, was it? Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton. Very difficult choice. I personally think, had a goldfish have represented one of the parties, I think that would have won rather than one of those two. The 2016 presidential race was the first for Hillary Clinton, but the Democratic candidate promises it won't be the last. Now, get this with the news. Last week, she announced her full consciousness, including memories, will be uploaded to a large server that can act as her brain once her body ceases to exist, allowing her to run for president until the end of time. She says, I'm going to run every 4 years until the machines take over. It's not even really about winning the presidency. It's just about being in the race for all eternity, says Clinton. She promises not to change her policies or approach in any way, even after the Earth evolves into a soulless planet run by artificial intelligence. Why change? If in the future our robot overlords can't appreciate my long career of hard work helping the unfortunate and standing up for the little guy, and then I say I'll just keep running until they do. So there's a little bit of Hillary Clinton news for you there, boys and girls. Are you liking the sound of that? Perhaps, you know, perhaps I could upload my consciousness into some machine somewhere and carry on doing my shows for all time. What do you reckon on that? Is that a good idea? Just a thought for you, just a thought. We'll do one more news item today, boys and girls, and then we'll disappear, all right? Here we go. How to clean your entire home in 20 minutes. 20 minutes, now that sounds good, doesn't it? In fact, after I've done the show today, I intend to get the Hoover out because the bin man comes tomorrow. God knows what he must think when he opens my green bin and smells the cat poo in there. Oh, it's all the stench, dear, stench. Whether it's the arrival of an unexpected visitor in this morning's Daily Mail or a last-minute get-together, all homeowners have experienced the panic of a last-minute clean. And when the time is tight before guests arrive, it can be difficult to know where to start. But now experts from cleaning firm Fantastic Services have revealed how you can get your home sparkling in under half an hour. Whether it's big or small, the house. Turn on the music. This is an unlikely first step that professional cleaners swear by. So put on the tunes and your rubber gloves and get down to business. By playing upbeat music, you'll remain motivated and stay focused on the task in hand. You only have a short period to clean and tidy, so you must be efficient. Efficiency is the only way, boys and girls. Open the window with the music playing. The next step is to throw open the windows, even if it's cold. Letting a blast of fresh air into the home will instantly make it feel much fresher and blow away any lingering odours. Now, I've noticed when I get out of bed in the morning, if I get out of bed, I go downstairs, I come back upstairs, there is an odour. And I don't know what it is. There's an odour coming from my bedroom. How strange. And how strange and mysterious. Yes. By the time you are done, your home will smell fresher, making it less stuffy no matter what mess remains. Put away the laundry. Clothes and clutter strewn around the living room can immediately make a house look messy. Start by tidying away any stray items of clothing from rooms your guests are likely to be in, even if this just means throwing them in the laundry basket. Next, move on to the clothes unceremoniously dumped in your bedroom. Now, I am guilty of that one. There are clothes always on my bedroom floor. What about yours? Are you a bit messy like that? Make your bed. It may be tempting to just shut the door and ignore the mess, but it's better to tackle the unmade bed. Make that bed. Messy. Messy. Clean the floors. Oh, God, that's the one I hate. It may be time consuming. Actually, it's not. There is one I hate more than cleaning floors. This is time consuming, but a must, even if you've just got a few spare minutes. Grab a vacuum cleaner or a broom and give the floors a quick going over, starting with the living room. Now, I quite like doing hoovering. Hoover. I quite like doing hoovering, I must say. It's the floor mopping, because my kitchen floor is like slate tiles, and you know, they're bumpy, not easy. And to have them changed now to flat tiles would be a blooming job and a half. It would. That's the one I hate, floor mopping all the time. Use a spray. Use a multi-purpose spray. Limits the amounts of products you need. Yes. Clean. Bathroom. I don't mind doing the bathroom. Although I only tend to do the toilet and the taps and the basin. I don't have a bath. I've got a shower. I don't usually bother to do the shower. And eventually I get those lines down the shower glass. And then I have to get the spray to get rid of that. Whatever that stuff is. What is it? Can't remember what that's called now. Take out the rubbish. I can't believe people have rubbish in the house. Dirty people. Get it out of the house. Tackle the bathroom. By far the most unappealing chore, wiping down the bathroom is a real must if you want your guests to feel comfortable. Make sure that toilet bowl is clean. Oh, have you ever been to a house and the toilet bowl is dirty with... God. Dirty people. How can you ask someone in the house and have a dirty toilet bowl, you disgusting people? So that's it. That's how you do it all in 20 minutes. Looking at that list, I really don't know how you would achieve all that in 20 minutes. You must be joking, mustn't you? Dear me. All right, let's do today's birthdays, and then I shall reveal to you, boys and girls, which was today's item of fake news. Every day, we have an item of fake news, boys and girls. Oh, it's the wrong jingle again. How annoying is that? And it doesn't fit in once I've tried it twice, so I'll come back to that. So I will be revealing tonight today's item of fake news after today's birthdays. It's birthday time, boys and girls. Just five today, I think we've got. Topsie Redfern is 36 years old today. Lovely person. She's a drag queen. She's really good at it as well. And a nice, nice person to work with. Happy birthday to Topsie Redfern. Happy birthday to Jake Aspie, 24 years old. He does his own videos. He's a much more professional. He's got a proper camera and all that business. So happy birthday to you, Jake. All right, 24 today. David Alexander Pollard, my good friend David Pollard. How are you, sir? 63 years old today. Happy birthday, David. Hope you're well, sir. Michelle Hess is 25 years old today. Happy birthday, Michelle. And Ian Spurgeon. It's his birthday as well today. So let's do today's birthdays. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Enjoy your birthdays, boys and girls. And now, to find out what today's item of fake news is.
We are fighting the fake news. It's fake, phony, fake. A few days ago, I called the fake news the enemy of the people, and they are. They are the enemy of the people. They're very dishonest people that I called the fake news the enemy of the people, the fake news. And now I'm saying, oh no, this is no good. But you are fake news. But I am only against the fake news media or press. Fake.
All fake. It's all fake news. In particular, fake news today was the one from Hillary Clinton, boys and girls. That was today's item of fake news. Her consciousness is not being uploaded to a big server. I don't think she's got much consciousness, so it's in fact going to be uploaded directly to a very small server the size of a postage stamp. And Stephen got that one this morning. He says that's the fake news story. It certainly is, all right? That's it today, boys and girls. Time to go. Now, let me see, where are we over there? Oh, so tonight, boys and girls, it's karaoke tonight. Now, it's Sunday, the 2nd of April, 2017. Tonight's karaoke, we only do one a month here now. That's at the Golden Lion in Sydenham, okay? If you want to join us there tonight, the Golden Lion in Sydenham for tonight's karaoke starts at 9 o'clock and finishes at 12 midnight. Hope to see some of you down there. But whatever you're doing, enjoy your Sunday. And I'm now going to clean my house in 20 minutes. Possibly not. The worst thing I hate dusting. Oh. Because you have to move things, don't you? You move them, you dust, and then you put... What I need is a declutter. You want to see the dust in here? No wonder I sneeze. Enjoy your Sunday. Cheerio now. Bye-bye.